a story. I will tell the world your story. Last time, I will tell the world your story. I will sing of your mercy. I will sing of your grace. I will tell the world your story. I will sing. Last time. I will sing of your mercy. I will sing of your grace. I will tell the world your story. I will sing. I will sing.
So we're going to do a little exercise today, and it's going to be an exercise of our will to praise him, exercise of our will to lift him higher, because he's good, and he's kind, and he's merciful, and he's awesome. He's been a healer. He's yet delivering. He's yet saving. He's yet setting the captives free. So we're going to give him the glory and the honor. Will you do it with me? You are God, and you're in control. Seated high, you are Lord of all. Great I am, sovereign ruler, Lion of Judah. You are God,
you are God,
and you're in control.
You're
seated high,
seated
you are Lord of all.
You're the Lord of all.
Great I am,
sovereign ruler,
Lion of Judah.
Lion of Judah.
One more time,
you are God.
You are God.
And you're in control.
Seated high. You're the Lord of all.
You're the Lord of all.
Great I am.
Sovereign ruler.
Lion of Judah. You are God.
You are God.
And this is what I love. Things will change.
When we call.
On that name. Great Jehovah. Things will change. When we call.
On that name.
Change.
When we call.
On that name. Things will change. When we call.
On that name.
Great Jehovah. Everybody clap your hands. God, we love you, Lord. We give you honor. We give you glory. We give you glory, God. You are God.
You are God.
And you're in control.
Seated high.
You're the Lord of all.
Great I am.
Sovereign ruler.
Lion of Judah.
You are God.
And you're in control.
Seated high.
You're the Lord of all.
Great I am.
Sovereign ruler.
Lion of Judah.
You are God.
You are God.
And you're in control.
Seated high.
You're the Lord of all.
Great I am.
Sovereign ruler.
Lion of Judah.
You are God.
Things will change.
When we call.
When we call on that name,
Great Jehovah. we won't stop praising. And we won't stop praising. And we won't stop praising.
No matter what it looks like.
And we won't stop praising.
No matter what it feels like.
And we won't stop praising.
No matter what they say.
And we won't stop praising. Praising your name, I just can't stop. Praising your name, I just can't stop. Praising your name, Jesus. Can't stop. Praising your name, I just can't stop. Praising your name, I just can't stop. Praising your name, Jesus. Big shout in here. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
You're good, and we won't stop praising.
Great Jehovah.
You're good,
and we won't stop praising.
Regardless of your circumstance, He has every answer. All He asks is that you leave it here. Great Jehovah, you're good and we won't
stop praising.
Great Jehovah,
you're good and we won't stop praising.
Great Jehovah. Jehovah,
you're good and we won't stop praising. Come on, come on,
say great.
Great Jehovah,
you're good.
You're good and we won't stop praising.
Say great.
Great Jehovah, you're good and we won't stop praising.
Hey, and we won't stop praising. We won't stop praising.
And we won't stop praising.
And we won't stop praising.
And we won't stop praising.
You ever get something in your spirit and you just, you can't let it go? We got somewhere else we need to go. But there's something about great Jehovah. You're good.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
And you won't, we won't stop praising.
Hallelujah. Glory to God.
Hey.
Yes, God. Hallelujah.
Won't stop praising.
And
so great Jehovah. You're good.
And we won't stop praising.
Great Jehovah. Say great.
Great Jehovah. You're good and we won't stop praising.
you're good.
And we won't stop praising.
Regardless of what we go through, he's great. We won't stop praising. We can't stop praising. Let's go. Say, great Jehovah, you're good, and we won't stop praising. Can y'all sing that with us? Say, great Just voices. Lift your voice and say, great
Jehovah,
you're good,
and we won't stop praising.
Come on, clap your hands. Say, great
Jehovah, you're good, and we won't stop praising.
And we won't stop praising.
Great Jehovah, you're good, and we won't stop praising.
Ah, that feels good in here.
Great Jehovah, you're good, and we won't stop praising.
Great Jehovah.
Great Jehovah, you're good, and we won't stop praising.
Father God, we just thank you for being good. When you look back, when we look back over our lives, God, we know that we don't deserve all that you have done for us, everything that you've walked us through and kept us through, Father God. But because you are great Jehovah, because of who you are, we can be who we are, Father God. We thank you because you didn't see filth and you didn't see dirt, but you saw love, Father God. And you picked us up off the ground, Father God, and cleaned us up so we can be with you. So, Father God, we lift our hands to you right now, Father God. We give our hearts to you right now. We just want to worship you in spirit and truth, Father God. Father God, we love you, we adore you, we bless your name. Father God, please accept our worship. Father God, please see our heart, Father God. Father God, cleanse our mind, Father God, so we can just concentrate on you and give you all the praise. And all these things we ask in your Son, Jesus' name. Somebody say hallelujah.
I want to be close by your side, where heaven is real and death is a lie. I want to hear voices of angels above, singing as one, singing hallelujah.
Heaven is real and death is a lie. I want to hear voices of angels above singing as one. Close.
say hallelujah. Holy, holy God Almighty. You're a great,
great I am.
Say, who is worthy?
Who is worthy?
None beside thee.
None become Holy Spirit.
God Almighty.
God Almighty. Great I am. Holy. Come on, come on, come on. Holy, holy, God Almighty, great I am, who is worthy, none beside me, God Almighty, great I am. Stay, watch me. Okay, listen real carefully. This was amazing worship. But there's a spirit of heaviness all through this place. All through, and I feel it. So the worship is hitting up against the wall. People are heavy in the heart. People are going through some things. So we're praying for people this morning. So I want you to, if you're not feeling that spirit of heaviness at the altar, please go back to your seat. Stay in the spirit of worship. Lift your hands out there. I don't want you spectating. I want you to pray. All right, guys, you watch me and you follow me. You paying attention? You follow me. All right? Now listen, listen. You're having a hard time. I'm coming back down. You're having a hard time. I don't care what it is. Sickness. I don't care what it is. Just a spirit. I have come, saith God. I have come. I have come, saith God, to remove your sorrow. I have come, saith God, to remove your pain. I have come and I am with you. Some of you want me to remove the struggle and pull you up. When I want to come down and be with you. When I want to come down. I want to come down and be with you so you will know me in a different way. So you will know me in a special way. Welcome me into your heart, and that touch will change your direction. That touch will change your direction. Some of you are in a season, saith God. He said, but I am with you in that season. But that season must come to pass. You will have to go through that season. This is a different word. Most people want me to end the season. When that season sometime is productive and needed in your life to draw you close to me. So this morning I come to be with you, saith God. Open your heart and receive. So if you're just struggling, let them help you and line up. Catchers, you guys stay with me. Come on, worship, Ann. Let's go. Y'all brought the presence of God in here. You first. Come here. It's okay. I love you so much, Ezekiel. I love you so much. So listen to me. Listen to me.
Twyla, come here. Twyla. Lift your hands. Lift your hands. Father, in the name of Jesus. Keep singing, Ann. You're fine. In the name of the Lord Jesus. Heaviness, go. Spirit of heaviness, you have to go because of the praise and worship. God is giving you the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. Heaviness, go and be broken over the lives of God's people today. You will not come to church and leave the same. Holy Spirit, hover. Holy Spirit, hover. Let your power be made available in this house and in this place in the mighty name of Jesus. Now, seasons turn. Seasons turn. Seasons turn. A lot of you are stuck. Seasons turn. Seasons turn. Seasons are ending, but it's going to be a little while, saith God. We're out of this microwave anointing and microwave season where something is just over immediately. Sometimes it is allowed to develop your faith and your closeness to God in the trouble. God does not always remove the trouble. He comes with you in the trouble so that you may know Him. So open your heart to God's presence in this season. In the name of Jesus. Are you Shauna? What's your name? Sean. I'm coming to see you Tuesday at 2 o'clock. I didn't forget you. Tuesday at 2 o'clock. You just beat me to it. I was going to text you. Come here. Hi, your husband. Yep, that's why we coming there too. But so do you. Paralyzed. They moved up here. Bedridden, paralyzed. Here it comes. Now you have some peace and rest. 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 Come here, come here, come here. Rest, Shauna. It's hard taking care. It's hard taking care. It's hard taking care. So now I release peace. Here it comes. Peace and no more fatigue. Come on, lift your hands. I get my hug today? Come on, Lorenzo. Just come with me. Lift your hands. God is here today. 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 Oh my gosh. Hold on, stay right there. Take him, hold him. Hold him like he was your kid. Move her stuff. It's all right. Step back. step back. It's okay. Peace. Peace.
Now, peace override the facts.
Peace override the facts. Peace. Oh, come here, Lorenzo. I'm jealous of your hair. Peace. You doing all right? All right. Every time I take him, I'm just giving him peace. So he store it up, okay? Stuff's coming. Stuff's coming at him. Future, okay? But he's going to be ready. But I want you to read the word over him every day. Like, read it out loud to him. Okay? So he's got to be built up. So when it comes, he can hack it. Okay? But I'm just warning you, it's coming. But it's not no problem. But you're going to have to keep him built up. Okay? God's going to use you in public. Okay? So sometimes you're going to have public stuff. Okay? But God has always got you. Every time I pick you up, I'm just giving you the peace that's in me and giving it to you. So you sleep good. You can remember all your lines. You can do everything God's called you to do. But what God is doing in you is he's going to do something. You are going to be famous. But he needs people that are famous that love him, not people that start off with him, get famous, and let him go. Do you understand me, Lorenzo? All right. Come on, lift your hands.
Beside me, God Almighty.
Only a season. You hear me? Look at me. It's just a season, right? It's not even a test. It's just a season. And you have to go deeper because of the call on you. Okay? And look at me. I'm not trying.
Come here, Mike, Maurice.
Oh, lift your hands.
How many of y'all know God is here?
Okay, but this is important. God is not here because of somebody walking around putting their hands on people. God is here because of your worship. You brought him here. So if you bring him here and you worship like you did today, he'll always come. And if he always come, we're going to always stop and we're going to always pray. We're going to always pray when God comes. But it doesn't depend on no pastor's anointing. It only depends on whether you're open enough to worship and bring Jesus here. If you bring him here, old things are passed away. All things will become new. Generational curses will be broken. Sickness and disease will die in the presence of God. Anxiety and fear will be broken. Cancer will die. Diabetes will die. Arthritis will die. Bone disease will die. Leukemia will die. But it's only if you worship. I'm going to undo what you think about Jesus, church, and the word of God over these next 4 weeks. You are the key. And this watching pastors, watching anointed evangelists, watching Christian TV, that stuff is over as the primary focus. The primary focus is whether or not you will love God with all of your heart and you will make God first. And when we come to worship, we don't beg you. You run to the altar and you worship. And if you'll do that, Jesus will come and he will move and he will eliminate. Listen to me. He will eliminate struggle if you want him more than you want to complain about the struggle. Lift your hand. Father, we honor you. Bless your word today, Father. Bless your word today. Peace to you, Augustus. I love you so much. Peace to you. Peace to your mind. Come here, Frank, and I want you to hug Augustus. Come here, stand up for me, Augustus. Augustus has been faithful ever since he's been here. He never misses a Sunday, and he ushers every single week. And he's got more challenges than you could imagine that he has to deal with every day. He's faithful. When things are not going well, he's still faithful. So now my prayer today is, Augustus, that your life would match your level of faith. That your life would match your level of faith. We love you so much, and I speak peace to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, come on, give Jesus a hand clap. Let's go. Come on, you can do better than that. Come on, lift your voice today. So, don't move. Praise and worship. You see what we were talking about yesterday? You're moving, Sonia.
I'm playing. I'm messing with you.
See what we were talking about yesterday? I don't got nothing to do with this. I ain't got nothing to do with this. Praise and worship team, y'all be faithful, and we'll see tumors dying in here in front of people. Do you hear what I'm saying? I'm telling you, I'm getting ready to go off for 5 weeks because we're messing up. We're not looking at Jesus correctly. If he comes, everything changes. The problem is we don't want him to come. And you can say what you want to say. We don't. When you stand there, I'm going to show you today what you're doing. You're killing him again. If you'll welcome him, our services will be in another universe. And people will actually come, tumors, and they'll shrink. Cancer will die, and then they'll go to the doctor, be verified, Frank, and they'll come back the next week and tell us what the doctor said and show us pieces of paper. How many of y'all are ready for that type of church? Or do you want to just keep hearing speeches? Man, nobody's interested in no speech when they're attacked with anxiety and fear. So I appreciate y'all. But now, going forward, you eliminate anybody that's not faithful. I'm saying it out loud and in public and on Facebook. You hear me? And if you get eliminated, if you're watching, because you ain't here, if you get eliminated, I did that. I don't care if it's one person up here. I'd rather have one person loyal to Jesus and his presence than 12 people that can sing good. Now, I'm telling you, in front of them, they don't show up, they're gone, and they can sit down or find another church. I mean that. I mean, we need God in here, and I'm going to eliminate every barrier that stops it. So come on, give Jesus a hand clap. Have a seat. Let's go. Come on, give him a better shout than that. Come on. Come on. Come on. It's about some power, not just talking and not just preaching. It's about the power of the Holy Ghost. Who's back there with you, Josh? Yell. Ruby! Ruby, I'm on one. So you're going to have to just stay with me. Okay? All right. Father, come in this, in Jesus' name, come in this house. Father, we are getting ready to open up a can of worms. So I thank you that people are not offended, but if they are, so what? We need your presence and your power, and we need to get rid of this unbelief. We need a genuine move of God. So, Father, going forward, this church, we repent, and we will not, as a church or individuals, keep killing you. So, Father, bless our character. Let us invade this culture. And let us transform this church so that it's salt in this culture and that people find you that don't know who you are. Anoint every single person in this place as if they were a minister or a pastor and unleash them on this desert. They're going to get attacked, though, Father. So I thank you that their faith fail not. Notice Jesus didn't eliminate the attack on Peter. He said, I pray your faith fail not. I pray right now your faith don't fail in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, so Ruby, I got a lot to do. We're going to be quick. Everybody say, killing Jesus again. Say it again. Is that possible? I know, quiet. Is it possible? Is it possible? Can we do that, Kendra? Can we? He got killed once. What are you? Can we do that, Mike? This will be the most significant series, Joe, over the next 5 weeks. And it's going to hit you like a ton of bricks. So take it like I'm taking it, and let's get something done. Everybody say, killing Jesus again. Point number one, Jesus is self-limiting. Do y'all know what that means? Most people don't know this. Jesus is self-limiting. What does that mean? He has all power, but he's decided in certain areas to limit himself to you. He's decided in some areas, even though he's sovereign and can do all things, he's decided to limit himself, Nicole, and his power to the faith of his people. Because if he doesn't, you will take for granted his power. So you need to see a limit on Jesus in some situations. Come on, you're going to be all right. Because he needs to show you that there's something you and I need to do. He's done all the heavy lifting here. Listen to me. He's done all the heavy lifting here. It's time for us to do some lifting. But his struggle is not with his goals and his objectives. His struggle is with the unbelief of his people. So what does it tell us? Jesus' power and impact is self-limiting. Mark 6, 5, and 6. And he could not do a miracle. Look at this, Kendra. And he could not do a miracle. What does could not do? He can't. How is that true, friend? He's Jesus. He could not do a miracle there at all because of their unbelief, except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and he healed them. And after he could do no miracles, Mom, he marveled and wondered at their unbelief because he had already healed leprosy. He had already opened blind eyes. He had already opened deaf ears. He had already done all these things, Jennifer. He comes here, and one translation says, Maurice, he could only heal a couple of headaches. So somebody explain to me how an all-powerful God that has created everything can only heal a couple of headaches. I'm going to tell you why, Rita, and this is heavy. Because his power is self-limiting. It doesn't mean you limit his power. It means he's allowed himself to be limited to your faith and my faith. Because he knows you'll take it for granted if you don't have to do anything. How many know if you give your kids everything, they won't value anything? If you give your kids, watch Ronald, if you give your kids everything, they won't value anything. So you and I tell them, hey, you need to work for it. So Jesus is saying, you need to work for it because I've done all the heavy lifting. I need you to believe. I'm taking you somewhere today, and this is only the foundation. Are you ready, Lorraine? Most of the time in the Bible, we forget, Doug, good to see you, brother, that God is talking to people that say they believe in him. Ruth Ann, he's not talking to sinners. He's not talking to these heathens. Most of the time, Frank, in the Bible, especially the Old Testament, God is like a parent dealing with his children. So Isaiah 29:13 says, the Lord says, these people come near to me with their mouth, and watch, Pastor Dora, and they honor me with their, but their, but their, but their, but their hearts are far from me, Janae. Their heart is far from me. He said, people talk, but their heart is far from him. Their worship of me is based on merely human rules they have been taught. Your relationship with Jesus should not come through your pastor. Pastors are only here to confirm and teach what has already been revealed to you. And I know this is going to be, we're going to be all in this, and I'm going to mess with your perspective in your head. Because we have messed up, Ron, and we have transformed this beautiful thing called a relationship with the creator of the universe into things merely taught by humans. So we've switched everyday longing, Joe, to be with Jesus to 90 minutes on one day, and it better not be 91. And then when we get to the 90 minutes, we have to be begged and pleaded with to lift our hands. Ruby, go back to the first slide because I like it better in color. Go back to the title slide. Why after that does he have to beg you to lift your hands? Because what I see is hands lifted. Oh, I see two hands lifted. The problem is, Mike, they're attached with nails. What's holding your hands down? Now I'm going to give a prophecy, and it's going to be terrible. So if you don't want to lift your hands voluntarily, he'll allow you to be nailed. That's that problem you're going through. If you don't want to lift them yourself, then he'll allow them to be lifted and attached. So lift them up voluntarily because your heart is right, not just your mouth. Or reject him, and he'll let the devil lift your hands up. Because the only way to make it through cancer, the only way to make it through tumors, the only way to make it through fear, the only way to make it through anxiety, the only way to make it through poverty, the only way to make it through struggle, the only way to make it through diabetes, the only way to make it through leukemia, the only way to make it through all the things that come to you is worship. Is to put God first over the problem so you know who he is in your life. You got to worship. You got to lift your own hands. You've got to worship because he was worshiping. This is worship. What? Is trust his daddy, he'll keep his word. Is trust that in this pain, his father sees. He trusts him. So without a fight, he stretched his hands out. As an example of what to do when you don't know what to do. You call it crucifixion. I call it worship and trust. Sometimes as a believer, we think the word is optional. Wait till, I can't even tell you what's coming. We think the word is optional. So watch. And don't lie. How many of you think the word is optional? Oh, boy.
no hands. I'm going to get back her lightning come. Somebody, Augustus is honest. See, that's why I love Augustus. You'll say, and you'll sit there because you don't want to be embarrassed, right? And you'll say you don't believe the word is optional. Do you read it every day? Do you read it regularly? Oh, all of you? Oh, come on. Don't do that. Don't do that. No, you don't. Because it's optional. But you just didn't raise your hand. Thus lies the problem. Believers are not honest about where they're at. You believe it's optional. And watch this. So you don't think I'm getting on you. I believe it's optional too. But you're the pastor. So? Because I pick things some days over him. I pick working for him over being with him. And I'm going to stand up here, and I'm going to be honest, Karen, about it. I get up, Evan, I look at my phone, and when I look at my phone first, that drives my whole day and my priorities. And when I look at my phone, I start texting and I start working for him because it's good stuff. Hey, I'm praying for you today. Instead of spending time with the one I'm praying to. So, let me be the first to say, I kill him all the time. You don't because you didn't put your hand up. Now, let me ask you again and see if maybe that little rant got you. How many of y'all believe the word of God is optional? Yeah, see? See, I shouldn't have to go through all that. It's all right. But we have to do better with Jesus. Not do better with church, not do better with helping people, not do better with serving, not do better. We have to do better with Jesus. And we have to stop disrespecting that picture. Proverbs 4, 4, and 5. Then he taught me and said to me, take hold. Everybody say, take hold. Watch, Kendra. Take hold of my words. Watch, Mr. Frank, with all your heart, not your lips, because your lips are far from me. Isaiah. Take hold with your heart, because out of your heart flows the issues of life. Sebastian, everything is tied up in our heart. It has nothing to do with our head. It has nothing to do with our mouth. It has nothing to do with our hands. It has everything to do with our heart. Because out of our heart flow all of our issues. If we have an issue, it is coming from our heart. It is not coming from another race. It is not coming from the government. It is not coming from politicians. It is not coming from your wife. It is not coming from your husband. It is not coming from your children. Well, Pastor Mark, you just don't know my life. I don't care about your life. I care about the scripture. And out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. And out of my heart flow my issues. And we have to start getting back to the Bible and not psychologists to explain what's going on. Take hold of my words. With all your heart, because I can't trust your mouth. Keep my commands, and you will live. Get wisdom, get understanding. That's called navigation. Let's navigate. If I got wisdom and understanding, I can navigate. Do not forget my words or turn away from them. The word, this is crazy, you ready? You know what the word turn away means in the Hebrew? It means to swerve. You know when I swerve, you know what swerve means, Miss Judy? Watch, when I'm driving and I see something that I don't want to hit, I swerve. You know what God says? Some of y'all don't want to hit my commands. Some of y'all don't want to hit my statutes. Some of y'all don't want to hit what I'm telling you. Some of y'all don't want to hit my will. So what you do is when I tell you something, when I reveal something to you, you swerve so you don't hit it. And that's why you don't read. Because you don't want me to tell you something that's against what you want to do. So you swerve. You swerve. And then you come back to me like I'm a butler on Crab Cracking Tuesday and Red Lobster only when you're ready. Jesus wants to be the steering wheel, not a spare tire.
What did you say? Yeah, a spare tire is for when you get a flat. And most of us have Jesus in the trunk. Only pull him out when we have a flat tire, when we have a sickness, when we have a disease, when we have a situation. Oh, let me go, Don. Let me go get Jesus out. Let me pop the trunk. They say in the hood, pop the trunk, fool. Let me pop the trunk and let me pull Jesus out. And so I want to pull Jesus out, Missy, because I need a spare tire right now. But here's the thing about spare tires, you know, they don't stay on. A spare tire gets you to your destination, and once you get to the tire shop, they put the spare tire back in the trunk. We want Jesus when we have problems, and we want to put him back in the trunk when everything's okay. Repeat after me, Kelly. Jesus. Again.
Man, don't swerve. Do y'all know this is just a salad? Some steak is coming.
The word is not optional on three things, and I'm going to break all three of these down, Pastor Kendra. And when I get to the church, it's going to be ridiculous. The word is not optional in our character. Say character. Say culture. Say church. The word, Miss Peggy, is not optional in our character. It is not optional in our culture. It is not optional in our church. Today is only the foundation. For the next couple weeks, Frisha, I'm going to break down what it means to kill Jesus in your character, what it means to kill Jesus in the culture, and what it means to kill Jesus in the church. And when I'm done with that, if you're bald-headed, you won't be, Mike. When we see and hear word or words, listen. When we see and hear word, now this is it, because I'm almost done. You ready, Ron? When we see and hear word, say, take my words, right? Take my words and put them in my heart. And take my words, right? When we see and hear word or words, here's the problem. You ready, Kitcher? Here it is. We think Bible. Hand me your Bible, Pastor Dor. Right there. What is that? That's a purse? I can't see. Mama, give me your Bible. My mama's like, give it back. You know where I live. This looks like a purse, too. So, Miss Yolanda, he says, keep my words, right? Keep my commandments. Now, I'm taking you somewhere. Watch, Tony. Keep my words. So, when we hear words, Joe, we think Bible. Because the Bible's called the Word of God. What's it called? Right. And that's okay. That's okay. But here's the problem. In John 1:1, you ready, Mike Isbell? Watch this. In the beginning, was there a Bible in the beginning? Were there papers in the beginning? Was there Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John in the beginning? Was there Deuteronomy in the beginning? Was there Revelation in the beginning? So it can't be the Bible. Watch, Miss Tony. Watch, Miss Tony. I'm going somewhere. So God says, so you don't get twisted, Kev. Watch. In the beginning was the Word, but there was no Bible, Miss Jean. There's no Bible. So in the beginning there was the Word, but the Word cannot just be the Bible. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word, what? Was with God. There's an error there that says the same thing twice. But that's okay. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God. In John 1:1, he breaks it out and says, there is the written word. Now here it is, Miss Chloe, Clarice. But the written word is an expression of the Word, and the Word, Stacy, is him. Okay, something is wrong. Okay, listen to me back there, because what I'm seeing is not my outline on the right. So let me give you a minute to figure this out. Talk to me for a second, Brooke. Is what I see on the right what's coming?
Okay, it's not, that's not my outline. Hand me my outline. Okay, go the next one up here. Let me see. I'm sorry, y'all. There it is. That's fine. So what I'm looking at up here, Brooke, is not right. So I don't know what's happening there. But Ruby, we're good. Just keep going because what you're showing me is what's there. But what's up here is not right. How many of y'all know the devil's crazy, but that's okay? Because I don't care. I'm going to fix it. We're going to fix it. And we're going to keep preaching. When we remove or kill the influence of the word, watch Kendra, in our character, when we kill it in our culture, or we kill it in our churches, we are crucifying Jesus all over again. I'm going to prove all this in a minute. When we kill the influence of the word, because guess what? The word is a person. The word is a person. Do you know you can be a parent and not have influence over your children? Anybody want to raise their hand, but you sit next to your children so you don't want to say it? You can be a parent and not have influence over your children. Are you listening? Now, I'm going to give you something. You can be a parent, have all authority, but not have influence over your children. Does this make sense, Lolita? Now watch. You can also be a Christian and Jesus not have influence over you. So then inadvertently you kill him again. Because you kill his impact. You kill his will. You kill what he wants for you. And once it's killed in your character, it spills over to the culture. And once it spills over to the culture ends up invading the church when the church was supposed to invade the culture. I know this ain't a clapper. Let's go to the next one. Rejecting Jesus Christ, who is the Word, is a slippery slope and will cause destruction. We are seeing it right now in individuals' personal character, what is right in our own eyes. People are doing what is right in their own eyes right now, Joe. People are making right wrong and wrong right. They are passing laws that are against God. Everybody's doing whatever they want to do. I just explained this to Kendra yesterday. We were talking yesterday. And you don't have to believe it, but trust me, I move prophetically like this. We were preaching stuff in 2012. You remember, Mike? That's happening right now. And part of my problem is sometimes I'm just too far ahead. And people go, yeah, that don't make sense, Mark. So check this out. There are 320 million Americans in the country. Only half of them vote. They say Joe Biden got 80 million. They say Trump had between 70 and 75 million. You put those numbers together, it's 150 million. So 150 million people go to the polls. Some vote correctly, some vote incorrectly. We say, what do you mean by that? Are you talking about the Democrats or Republicans? No, some vote for God and some vote against God. And some Christians vote against God. I don't care what you think. So there's 150 million, that's about roughly half of the 320 million. The 150 million, one half of them put a politician or put a president in office. And everybody goes crazy about the process. Everybody goes crazy about who gets elected. Half of the country's happy, half of the country's not. Let me tell you prophetically what the bigger problem is. The 150 million that don't voice their voice at all, that don't want God in the first place. Because everything about you comes from the news, so you can't see facts. Americans don't want righteousness. Americans don't want holiness. Americans don't want purity. So Americans put people in office that cause America to be judged.
We ignore the word. We ignore Jesus in our character. We do what's right in our own eyes. We do what's right in our own culture. Sin is running rampant. And we do it in the church because there ain't no power. So let me close with this. Well, I'm just getting started, Sean. I'm just getting started. It's going to be half of these people here next week. I already know how it go. I already know how it go. Pastor Mark, where do you get the title from? And saying, why would I say, put the first picture up for me, Ruby, if you can, please, baby. Why would I get up here and yell and scream, Janae, and say, killing Jesus again? Because I'm yelling and screaming. You know I'm like a rapper, right, Janae? Okay. All right. She says, yes, I know. Why would I say that? How many times did he die, Kendra? So my title don't make sense. How many times did Jesus die? Tell me. So why would I make a title like this? Go to the last one for me, Ruby, Hebrews. You ready? This is one of the most complicated scriptures other than Matthew 7:21, Mike. There's interpretive challenges, Matt, to this. Some of you are going to go home after this Sunday and you're going to read it and you're going to end up on two sides of the thing. And some of you are going to say, I don't understand the scripture because it's about Christians. And once saved, always saved, you're going to get into all that discussion. And then some of you are going to go home and study this week and you're going to come back and you're going to say it's about non-Christians because it can't be about Christians. So I'm telling you, I'm not preaching about either one of those issues. I'm preaching about something else. So Hebrews, they say it was written by Paul. Watch what it says. It tells a story. It is impossible, say impossible. Now listen very carefully, Teresa, watch. It is impossible for those who have once been enlightened, who have tasted the heavenly gift. How many of y'all know what the heavenly gift is? What do you think that is? Salvation. Who have tasted, I know this is complicated, but stay with me. Who have tasted the heavenly gift, go like this. Who have tasted the heavenly gift, who have shared in the Holy Spirit. That's why it's not the Holy Spirit, Ryan. See what I'm saying? Tasted salvation, have shared in what, Brooke? The Holy Spirit. Who have tasted the goodness, look at this, of what, Kendra? Of the Word of God in their Bible. And the powers of the coming age. You saw a little bit today. The powers of the coming age, Rita. Watch this. Watch Evan. And who have fallen away. All those people, Minister Frank, they've tasted. Isn't that ugly? They've tasted. They've shared. They've read, Lonnie. And what happened to them? Have fallen away to be brought back to repentance. And because of this factor, are y'all ready? And we're done. You ready? And because of that, what, Rita? To their loss, some of y'all didn't even know that scripture was in the Word of God. Look at your neighbor and say, am I killing Jesus again? To their loss, they are crucifying the Son of God all over again. And here it is. And subjecting him to public disgrace. You and I, you ready, Nicole? Me and you can kill Jesus again and again and again and again. And every time we kill him, from the second time on, it's a public disgrace, Mom. Because we have been walking around, Mike, talking
about we're believers. We're Christians. We love God. And then after you kill him, the people that heard you see how you live. And guess what this means? Killing Jesus again means you treat the first crucifixion with contemption. Contemption means disgrace, and you don't appreciate it. So you ready? How do you kill him again? You take what you want to do and make it more important than what he did. Not my will, but yours, Jesus said. You take what you want to do over what he already did. So the Christians reject the authority and influence of the word and vote crazy, live crazy, get attached to ideology that's demonic. And when you do, you kill him. Because you've just killed his influence in your character. You've just killed his influence in the culture. And then you bring that nonsense to church, and you bring that unbelief to church, and you bring that non-biblical worldview to church, and he can't even move in the place he's supposed to. Because he's self-limited to what you and I might believe. And then the church has no power in the culture. It makes his name a public disgrace. And then the people, Laura, reject him because his messengers keep killing him. Let's give him a hand clap. That's it. Come on, you can do better than that. I know something is wrong. I know you're having a hard time. Come on, come on, come on. I know you're having a hard time. I know this don't make sense. You don't want to say you're killing Jesus. You don't want to say, yeah, I'm killing him in my culture. I'm killing him in my character. I'm killing him in my church. But we got to do better. The word is Jesus Christ, and Jesus Christ is not optional. He's not optional in the morning. He's not optional in the night. He is not optional in my vote. He is not optional in my choice. He is not optional in my marriage. He is not optional with my kids. He is not optional in my life. He is not optional. Let's go to my picture. So here it is. Not an option. If you're new to us, for months and months and months, greatest words ever spoken. So thankful to Stephen Scott. This is not a book with an opinion. It is all the words of Jesus broke down by category. How many of y'all have one? It's got to be every day. It can't be an option. You have to look at hope if you need hope. Tana, and you read that page, and you'll hear Jesus talk to you about hope. This entire series, this entire church, we have to be about Jesus every day on a daily basis. And stop believing 90 minutes can override 7 days. Take a picture with your phone. Order this. And this has to be just like breakfast or just like dinner. So if this church shuts down and can never open up again, you, the church, are still being fed. Come on, lift your hands. Come on, come on. I know it's tough. I know it's tough. Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus, forgive us. Forgive us for killing you again. Forgive us for killing you again, Father. We think you're optional because we think reading the Bible is optional. But the Bible is you, Jesus, and you are the Bible. So we cannot interchange them. We've made a public disgrace because we walk around with no power. We walk around with unanswered prayers. We walk around just like the people that don't have you. So what is the difference? Father, we repent today and we will move closer to you on a daily basis so we stop killing you in public and killing you in private and killing you in our family and killing you in our church.
Jesus, you are the most important person ever. And we must embrace you and have a relationship with you and not treat you like a spare tire only when our life gets a flat. Jesus, you are the steering wheel and you are the gas that makes us go. We repent before you, Father, and we will not kill you again. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on, give him a shout. Come on, you all right? Come on, you got to be tough. This ain't a place for no babies. If you're here today and you're living your life without the power of Jesus, without the authority of Jesus, this whole message was an altar call. You stand to your feet right now. If you've been a Christian and you've been treating the Word of God and Jesus as optional, you stand to your feet right now. If this message hits you in your heart today and you know you have to do better, you stand to your feet right now, and I'm going to lead you through two different prayers. If you are on Facebook and you don't have any pre-existing conditions and you live locally, you need to be here if there's not a good reason for you not to be here. Some of you watch because you have to work and those things, and that's why we broadcast it, and that's why we will always broadcast it. But some of you have used COVID as an excuse. I'm calling you back to the house of the Lord. The Bible says, forsake not the assembling of yourselves together. And online church is not a replacement for assembling together with other believers. If you have a good reason to watch, keep that reason. But if you don't, I'm calling you out right now. If you're here today, all of you are standing. Lift your hand today. We must do better. We can't keep killing Jesus and making him a public disgrace. We have to love him with all of our heart, mind, soul, and strength. Some of you have never had a relationship with Jesus. When I get through these weeks and you see that Hebrews 6 is like a Judas, you're going to decide whether or not you're Judas or the other 11 disciples. Around Jesus all the time, but reject his authority and reject his influence. If you're here today, you must be born again, this time in God's family. And if you're born again, you will have a hunger for him and his word. If you do not have a hunger for him and his word, I will tell you to your face, you are not born again. If you don't want him, he's not in you. Because he wants him. He wants him. The Holy Spirit wants you to read so you can remind yourself that he's in there. You're like an Oreo cookie. You're the cream. And the Holy Spirit is one wafer and the Word is another wafer. And he wants to reach out and hear from himself through you so you're so full you can walk like Jesus and move like Jesus and talk like Jesus on a daily basis. No word, no power, no influence. And you make him a public disgrace. Repeat after me. Dear Jesus, I didn't know I was killing you again. I repent while I still have time. Come into my heart. Live through me. But help me in my mind to make you first. You're already first in my heart. But my mind has to be renewed to follow you and make you my priority. Save me today. Restore me today. Restore my hunger for you. Lord Jesus, today is different. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on, give Jesus a hand clap. Come on, come on, come on, come on, shout to God with the voice of triumph. Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on. Today's a different day. Today's a different direction. You will not kill Jesus again. Now listen, there's too many people for the ushers and them to do whatever it is they do. So I want you to know with all my heart, you order the greatest words ever spoken, and you have to have a relationship with it every day or this is not going to work. Amen? Now, come on, give them a shout. Amen. I don't know if somebody was able to count, but we'll see. We'll see. We'll see. Coming up, Pastor Kendra. Y'all all right? All right, Facebook, listen, we love you. And I know you're like, well, you don't love me because you just told me to come to church. Yes, 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 yes. I'm a good dad. That's what I'm going to do. If you have a pre-existing condition, work or something else, cool. But Do not let COVID transform your life. Forsake not the assembling of yourselves together. And if there's no good reason for you not to do it, shame on you. I love you, though. And you share this? Well, I don't know if you should share it. Don't share this one. You just read it yourself. So goodbye, Facebook, on the count of three. One, two, three.
We are abundant nation.
Peace out. Come on, give God a shout.
Hello, all right. Everybody. Are you all right? Pastor Mark and Pastor Kendra. And we've come to this time of our service where you have a wonderful opportunity to give and invest in the kingdom of God here at Abundant Living Family Church, High Desert. So I want to give you two thoughts today as you prepare to give today. Number one, heaven always supports people, and those people are commanded in Scripture to support the work of heaven on earth. So let me talk about the first one, heaven supporting people. When you give right now and you give your seed, we're going to give you some ways to give in a moment, but when you give your seed, heaven brings a harvest to that. The Bible calls the Lord of the harvest, which means your pastor's not in charge, the church is not in charge, no other human is in charge of your harvest other than the Lord Jesus Christ. So when he calls himself the Lord of the harvest, that means he is watching what you and I are investing in his kingdom. So that's heaven supporting you. Now, once you get blessed and you get your harvest back from the Lord, you get it through your paycheck from working hard, then you invest in the kingdom of heaven on earth. God moves through people. God can bring all the money out of heaven he wants, but God is looking at your faithfulness. He's looking to see if he can trust you with the harvest. So when you are giving, the Greek word is didymai, and didymai, literally embedded in that word, is give and receive. So every time you give, every time you plant a seed, God, you also set in motion the harvest so you can receive. Amen. Here at Abundant Living Family Church, we do so many things in our community and even outside of our state. Number one, we have a great reentry program. We help people that are homeless. We help people that don't have a job. We help people that are getting out of jail here locally. We've transported over 18,000 people. How do we do that? We do that through your generosity and your giving, and then we help them once they get out. So it's a wonderful, wonderful blessing. So when you plant your seed, you are helping where you live. We always say we live here. So you're sowing into the high desert. Now, even if you don't live here, that seed doesn't matter, because that seed is eternal. And remember, the Lord of the harvest always sees. But then it's important not to just give to where you live, but to also give to the kingdom of God. So we have a well that we dug in India. We support that over there in India. We have a tremendous feeding program in Uganda where we send money every single month, and they feed 200 to 400 people in Uganda. It's just a wonderful, wonderful ministry there. And then we also are getting ready to start working with an orphanage in Mexico. They're going to have 6,000 kids. Wow. That have no parents.
Wow.
So listen, Abundant Living Family Church High Desert is involved, and we are making sure the kingdom of God is operating here on earth. So you say, well, Pastor Mark, Pastor Kendra, how do I give? There are three different ways you can do that for us today. You can also go on the app, the Abundant Living Family Church app. You can go on our website, AbundantLivingHD.com, and then you can also do text to give. You would text 77977 to ALFCHD. Three different ways to sow a seed, three different ways to give, but three ways to get a harvest. And then once you get that harvest, God can trust you to be a blessing and bring his kingdom on earth. And we always like to close our service with this. We are abundant living. God bless you, and thank you for giving today.